you remember the week before Easter, Jesus had raised Lazarus from the dead. Amen. That's what we're celebrating today.
Zechariah 9, hear the words of the prophet. Rejoice greatly, O daughters of Zion. Shout, O daughters of Jerusalem. Behold, thy king cometh unto thee. He is just and having salvation, lowly, riding upon an ass and the foal of an ass. But listen to these words that go on to say that he promises, I will cut off the chariot of Ephraim and the horse from Jerusalem, and the battle bow shall be cut off, and he shall speak peace unto the heathen, and his dominion shall be from sea even to sea, from river even until the ends of the earth.
Praise the Lord. Amen. 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 Pastor Dylan, would you check on our lovely children? Are they ready?
Are
our children ready? Can you check on those kids? Do we have children ready? We have a great celebration we want to do this morning. If you remember the Palm Sunday where Jesus came into Jerusalem and the people recognized him this time. He had just raised Lazarus from the dead. And he came back into Jerusalem and he came riding on that donkey, on that young colt. And he comes riding in and the children began to sing praises. They began to lift up palm branches and wave them in the air, and they were dancing and praising, and the people began to lay their coats down on the ground for Jesus to walk across those with those on that donkey, and they began celebrating, here is our king, Hosanna, Hosanna, here is our king. And it was an awesome celebration. And some of the religious leaders weren't ready for Jesus. They were like, do you hear what your disciples are saying? Do you hear what these children are saying? Don't you think you should stop them from saying that? Jesus said, I tell you the truth. If these children don't do what they're doing, even the rocks will cry out and praise the Lord, because they knew who Jesus was. Amen. So kids, bring in the celebration this morning. Amen.
Rise and fall.
welcome you to Rockettown Church this morning. God bless you for being here. Those who are joining us online, including our beloved pastor who is home with something. So he has been seeing a doctor about some a skin condition that he's not sure what it is, but we don't want to share. So he is going to stay home and take care of that, and we'll find out more from the doctor what's going on. But keep him in your prayers this morning. This morning we are celebrating what God did. God loved the world so much that he gave his only son, that whosoever believes in him, in Jesus, shall not perish, shall not die, but have everlasting life. That is a promise. And for all the things that we think, oh, if I could just be good enough to get into heaven, if I could just be good enough, maybe if my good outweighs my bad, guess what? That will never happen. It's never going to happen. And God knew that. So he sent his son Jesus, and Jesus came, the perfect man and all God, and he had no sin. And he lived on this earth like us, but he had no sin. And then he gave his life to pay for our guilt. The debt that we owed, he paid willingly, lovingly, and with a plan. Because that blood that Jesus spilled on the cross covers our sins. And when we say, Jesus, forgive us of our sins, every sin is washed away. Amen. And we are made brand new. And when we say, God, do you remember that thing I did last week that was so wrong? He goes, no, no, it's gone. It's gone. It's gone. And that's such an awesome, awesome thing. It's only because of the blood of Jesus, not our own righteousness. And that's what we're going to sing about this morning.
Thank you.
some exciting things going on at Rockettown, and Cynthia is going to bring those announcements to us. If you're visiting for the first time, we want to give you a present for coming. Just give us a little wave. Someone's going to give you a visitor pack. In that visitor pack, there's a communication card. Fill that out. Drop it in the offering vessel sometime today. We want to send you a gift this week for visiting, and thank you for being here today. We hope you feel like family. Cynthia, go ahead.
Good morning, everyone. Happy Palm Sunday. Okay, first up is we have the Holy Week schedule here, and you can pick up the schedule on the info desk right outside in the lobby, and it's got all of that information on it. Okay, number two, April 6th at 8 a.m., we're having the breakfast, and like we always mention, we bring you with bacon, so you'll have something to eat. It's really good. And on that same day, we're having a clothing swap amongst the women, and just bring in your pretty clothes yet you want to share and bless someone else with them. It's a great day of free shopping. I love it. Okay, and I brought them in my car today. I read the announcements, but I don't pay attention. I don't know what's wrong with me. Okay. The next one is new members class sign up is in the foyer. It'll be April 21st at 8 a.m. And you won't be disappointed on that. That's a great class. Okay, so please do it. Meet Need is Sunday, April 21, after service at 1 p.m. at Fox Lake. Okay, so the pavilion is located at the entrance and the exit area of the park. So we'll have to travel all the way around to come all the way back up. But that'll be fun. Okay, so another thing we've got, your memory verses, February on the wall in the foyer, they're all, somebody was so sweet, made all the verses for the month, and they're little pieces of paper. So we're up to March, so go ahead and grab January, February, and March just to have them. So as you can see, they're listed there, but they're right out front. Today, the member photos, just meet right out front if you want to get your member photo in the directory, and right by where the praying hands are on the wall, that's where we'd like to take the pictures of you. So just grab somebody, we'll take a beautiful picture of you. Okay, prayer group is April 7th from 6 to 7, obviously here at the sanctuary, right? And that's Sunday, in the Sunday evening, that'll be a beautiful time to get together and just pray. So that's always needed. The beautiful sunrise service, Easter sunrise, 6:45 a.m., 7:45, unless the sun decides to change its direction. And that will be next Sunday at the Marina Park. And did y'all notice they're having biscuits and gravy? So that'll keep you there, too. It'll be a beautiful morning. So if anybody doesn't know where Marina Park is, just get with somebody. We'll make sure everyone knows where we're going to be at. Okay, and it seems like there was one more thing, but I guess
there
I'm dreaming.
It is Thursday night.
Yes.
Do you have that one?
No, I have
some. Okay, so Thursday night is traditionally a Passover service. And what that means is that we're going to wait till sundown because they celebrated the Passover at sundown. So I believe sundown on this Thursday evening is at 7:39. So at 7:39, we're going to gather. Choir will meet just before then. But at 7:39, we're going to meet, have communion together, remember the Lord's Supper together as Jesus did with his disciples. And we hope you will come to that. And then Friday evening is a Good Friday service at, Sherry, I'm looking at you. Was it on there? All right, Good Friday service. You know what? Is it up there? Glasses.
Oh, okay.
All right.
Oh,
5:30 on Good Friday evening. Okay, so you know what? And I apologize because that shows 6:30. I thought we were doing it at sundown.
Oh, it says Friday 5:30.
So Thursday it says 6:30, and Good Friday it shows 5:30. But we'll let's do that. So, okay, so anyway, come join us for both of those. And this Palm Sunday week, Pastor Steve is going to do an online video every day at noon. And it's just a short teaching. It's going to cover different things. And so if you just kind of want to get yourself prepared for Resurrection Sunday morning and just kind of really sense what God did for us, it's going to be on Facebook, and he'll probably share it to the YouTube page as well so that we can make sure everybody gets to see it. Peggy.
There's
a
right.
special gift, sunrise service. Yes. Hey, come on. Jesus rose early in the morning. We should too. Right, Dad? All right. Peggy?
It says up there sunrise service is at Sandville.
That's not true. Sunrise service is at Marina Park. Marina Park. So you pass on US 1, and you turn left at the end of Garden Street, and you turn left, and you go past the entrance of Sandpoint. The next entrance takes you down to a marina, and Marina Park is on your right. We will have some maps in the foyer. So if you need a map, they're set for you, already set in the foyer. Thank you, Sherry, for having those ready.
All right. And just one more thing. I did notice y'all have choir practice for Easter Sunday after service, 30 minutes. Okay. All right. That's it.
Super good.
Thank you.
All right. We love to continue our worship and our giving. What giving does is it shows that our trust is in God. He gives us abundantly above all we could ask or imagine. And so when we give to the Lord in our offerings, it meets the needs of the church. It meets the needs of the building, yes. But what it really shows is that where my treasure is, there my heart will be also. So I give my first fruits to the Lord. Whatever I get is an income. I say, Lord, the first 10% is yours, just because I want to prioritize you first. And God promised, and he said, this is the one dare, double dog dare ya. This is the one thing where he said, I dare ya. Prove me. Test me on this. If I won't open the windows of heaven for you and pour out a blessing so great that you won't be able to contain it. And God is faithful. He is abundantly beyond faithful. So as we give to the Lord, make it an act of worship. The Bible says he loves a hilarious giver. He loves a cheerful giver. Doesn't want you to give out of, it's duty. It might be duty for you, but make it an act of love. Make it an act of worship to the Lord and let the Lord bless you this morning. Frank, would you pray over our offering this morning?
Heavenly Father, we come to you, more than willing to share of what you've already given us. We ask that you bless this offering, and using the, as they say, God math, you can expand it into doing whatever you want it to do.
Jesus.
And Father, I thank you for the opportunity that we have to invest in your kingdom.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. There's lots of ways to give. You can give by phone, text the number, give. You can do Church Connect, or you can give by way of the slider in the back, a little drop box in the back. There's lots of ways to give. But however you do it, just do it joyfully to the Lord. We're going to open up the altars for our prayer team this morning. And if we've got some of our prayer warriors that would come up, if you need the Lord to touch your body, to touch your finances, to touch your relationships, to touch your emotions, you just need a touch from God and you need him to minister to you, come pray together. We believe in the power of prayer. We believe that what God does, he ministers his spirit through his body, through us, through our hands and feet. So as you are worshiping this morning, be praying for those who come up to the altar and are believing for God to minister and touch their life. In Jesus' name.
Behind heaven's throne to build it here inside. There at the cross you paid the debt I owed. Broke my chains, freed my soul for the first time.
tomb of sin. You were buried for 3 days, but then you walked right out again.
Woo!
And now death has no sting, and life has no end. For I have been transformed by the blood.
From this state of sin and captivity that we were held in. Lord, thank you, Jesus, for the freedom that you bought us, that you redeemed us from the hand of the enemy who was out to destroy us, and we are no longer subject for destruction anymore. Lord, thank you that you put our feet on a rock. Thank you, God, that you put a new song in our mouth, a hymn of praise to our God, that we can lift up your name, Lord God. We can bless your name, Lord. We can praise you and give you all glory and honor and praise because you are worthy. Worthy is the Lamb of God. Lift up your voices, church. Worship in truth, in spirit. Hallelujah, Lord. We worship you, Lord God. You are so good, Lord. You are so good, Lord. Just sing that one more time.
Glory to you.
Introduce Pastor Sam to you. Take that word this morning and just share it with us. Amen.
Praise the Lord. It is so good to be here today. This is Palm Sunday. I am having a surgery tomorrow. I had a knee replacement 21 years ago, and they're replacing the replacement. A little later, they have to work on the other knee that I had replaced because I got a recall a few weeks ago. But there's a part needs to be recalled. You know you're getting old when you get body part recalls, okay? It's that time to do that. So I wasn't sure if I'm going to do everything in the world to be here next Sunday for Easter and sing in the choir and all of that, but I knew I may not be able to dress up a great deal for Easter, and since my mother would turn over in her grave if I wasn't dressed up on Easter Sunday, because she used to make us five boys and that little girl our suits and dresses every year for Easter. So I thought, well, I'll try it for Palm Sunday anyway. And so I know somebody said to me when they came in, I didn't get the notice on the dress code today. Well, I know people say, I had a man say to me one time, why do you insist on every Sunday cutting off your carotid artery for about 2 hours, you know, with this? I didn't know that's what I was doing. And I gave him the same answer I always give, you can't hide class. Anyway, never mind. No, this is just a funny line. You were supposed to laugh there. Anyway, thank you, darling. Appreciate that help this morning. Pastor called me fairly late in the evening last night to say he had just finally decided against trying to do what he loves to do and be here, would never not be here if there was any other possible way, and ask if we could quote that scripture again, be instant in season and out. And could we find something? You all know how wallflowered I am, how backward I am, how public speaking is just such an embarrassing thing for me. So I told him, I will try to find something to say, if at all possible. So you pray for me that I can get a couple words out today here that'll be a challenge. I know in our sequence what he's been preaching on the series. He told me, he said, if you don't have to, but if you want to, go ahead where I was going to go and talk about instruct carefully. And I began to realize as I started toying with that idea, I don't think I've ever instructed carefully in my life. It's not my style. My style was do it, you know, and that doesn't work all the time. I also realized it is Palm Sunday. And I got thinking about it and wanted to talk about it. Stay with me this morning. Put your seatbelt on. You might try to take notes if you like to take notes. I doubt you will be able to because pretty quickly here this morning. I will have every one of you home by 2:30 this afternoon, so it's not a problem. But I'm going to move as quick as I possibly can. Easter week, Holy Week, we start it now. We're there. We're at this place. Turn with me, if you will, to Matthew. And I want to read a couple of verses as we start from Matthew 21. And those first 9 verses I want to read to you. This is from the NIV. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage in the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent 2 of his disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If any say anything to you, say that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away." This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. I quoted that scripture earlier in Zechariah when we said the prophet. And the disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and placed their cloaks on them for Jesus to sit on. And verse 7 says, did we miss 7? I read 7, didn't I? A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted, listen to these words, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna to the highest in heaven." Let me tell you this week. Every day this week, turn in at noon if you can. Check pastor's little thing he's going to share every day. But listen to this. I want to recount that week quickly with you today, all right? On Sunday, he entered the city triumphantly. The day after the Sabbath, he entered the city. We saw it. Kids demonstrated. We heard about it. Monday, he curses a fig tree for unfruitfulness. And he cleanses the temple, driving out the money changers. And he does a healing in the temple. On Tuesday, his authority. And on Wednesday, he gives the parable of the prodigal son and the parable of the wicked servant and the parable of the king's son. And he teaches on paying taxes. And he's questioned by the Sadducees. Give the great commandment, he does. The great commandment. Love the Lord your God, all your heart, all your mind, all your strength, and your neighbors, yourself. You do that one, you've kept all the other ones. He pronounced woes against the Pharisees. He points out the Greeks come and visit him. He warns about unbelief. He prophesies the coming tragedy of that week. He foretells the signs of the second coming when he's going to return. He gives the parable of the 10 virgins and the parable of the 10 talents. And he preaches about Judgment Day. And the plot of Jesus and Judas is revealed at the end of Wednesday. And then comes Thursday. He makes the preparation for the Passover. He settles the strife between his disciples. He shares the Passover meal with them. He washes his disciples' feet. He designates a traitor among his disciples. And he shares the original Lord's Supper, as we call it. He gives the words. He gives the parable of the true vine. He promises the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. He enters into intercessory prayer. Agonizes in the garden, and he sweats drops of blood, and he's betrayed, and he's arrested, and he performs his final healing miracle when Peter cuts off Malchus' ear, and he heals it back on. And then come Friday, he's brought before the high priest pretty early in the morning. Peter denies him. He's brought before the Sanhedrin. He's brought before Pilate. He's sent to Herod. Pilate released Jesus. Pilate's wife appeals for Jesus. Jesus is beaten and scorned. Pilate washes his hands. Pilate approves the death sentence. Jesus is mocked. Judas commits suicide. Jesus is led away to be crucified. The women are weeping for him. All but John flee and hide. Jesus is nailed to the cross. The soldiers cast their lots for his clothes. The dying thief confesses him. Jesus commends his mother to John. Darkness falls on Golgotha. Jesus dies. And the veil of the temple is torn in two. And the Bible says graves opened when that happened. The centurion declares at the foot of the cross, "This was the Christ. This is him." His body's taken off the cross. He's buried in a borrowed tomb. The stone rolled over the mouth of the tomb. And a military watch is placed in front of that tomb. And Saturday, he's traveling. Oh, yes, body's in the tomb. But he's traveling. Yeah. On Saturday, he visits a realm called paradise. He said to the thief on the cross, he didn't say you're going to be with me in heaven. He said you're going to be with me in paradise. Paradise was called by some the bosom of Abraham. Paradise was the place in the parable of the man in hell that looked up and saw him in the bosom of Abraham. Saw him with Father Abraham. He wasn't in heaven yet. That was the place that those believed that he was going to someday come and be the Savior of the world. And they believed it so much, he counted it faith for them, and he put them and held them in a paradise place until he could yell the words from the cross, "It's finished." And he held them there in security. He visits that realm of paradise, and he preaches the gospel to the old covenant saints that believed it was coming but never heard it. And the Bible says he took captivity captive, something that he went to hell and gave sinners a second chance. He did not. He did not. He went to paradise. And he preached that gospel that those had not had but believed in it before they even had it. And he took that captivity and said, "I'm going to captive you again." And he took them to heaven. I believe it all happened so fast that the thief on the cross was the last one to check into paradise and the first one to check into heaven. It happened that quick. And then he makes one more trip. Now he goes to wherever Satan is. Satan is not in hell. If you think Satan is a guy with red leotards and horns and a pitchfork that stands in hell and throws souls of the damned into a furnace all day long, you don't know Satan. Satan is not in hell. The last place he wants to be is hell. I got some good news. The last place he will be is hell. He's the prince and power of the air. I can tell you, I can give you his address. It's right between my mouth and your ear. That's where he lives. So I say to someone, "I really love you today." And Satan grabs and turns and twists that and says, "What are you trying to tell me? Gee, I wish you'd make it to church Sunday." And devil grabs that and twists it and says, "Why don't he leave me alone? He's always riding me about go to church thing." If the last thing you say at my funeral is that guy drove me crazy trying to get me to live for God, please do that. Please do that. Now watch this. The beauty, the reality. He comes down there and he snatches the keys of death, hell, and the grave from Satan's hand, and he places his foot firmly on the neck of the pernicious one and says, "Now you'll be under my foot." Amen. Satan's in the power of the air, but the power of Christ is in me. It's in you. My mother used to tell a story that people walking down the street and they saw the devil on the street corner crying one day. Just crying his eyes out, boo-hooing. And someone said, "Devil, why are you sitting here crying?" He said, "Everything that happens at that Rockettown church, they blame me for it." We blame the devil for a lot of stuff. And I'm not lightening his influence today. I'm telling you, the demon I'm possessed by, I shave him every morning. My biggest challenges are my decisions and my copes. I know when he comes. You know when he comes. You know where that voice comes. And you know how to resist it. But I'm telling you, he is under the feet of the one that's controlling and standing under you with everlasting arms. That's what he did that day. And then came Sunday. April prayed during our prayer time this morning. Then she talked a couple times up here. I whispered to Michelle, "I hope she leaves me something left to preach this morning." It's in our heart. It's in our spirit. It's where we're at. Easter. I'm not going to preach Easter Sunday. Pastor will take care of that. But the morning begins with an earthquake. Morning begins with an earthquake. And when Mary finds an empty tomb, if
I were to take you to Russia today and take you to Red Square, I could take you into a place and I could show you a glass-covered casket that's been pumped with special air. It's kind of like been hermetically kept in a mason ball jar. There's a body in there, and there's a little gold plate that says on that body, "He was the Savior of the world." You can look at it and see it. He was the Savior of the world. That body with Lenin, the creator of communism, socialism. I'm going to tell you something. Lenin was not the Savior of the world. You know why I know? I can see his body laying right there. I've also been to Jerusalem, and some of you will go again with me next February. Yes, we're going. Some of you will go to Israel with us next February. I've walked in to a garden that they found many, many years ago, actually the year I was born. They found that garden. They excavated that garden. They found out there were tombs in that garden. They found that garden set right below a hill, that if you look up, it looks to this day like a skull setting up there. And they found first the water cistern, knew there must have been a garden, found the garden, dug it out pretty well, began to mark it out. And most of us really believe to the depth of our heart, especially if you've ever stood there, we believe to the depth of heart, that's the place where they took him off that cross by that skull, brought him down and put him in that tomb. When you walk through the door of that tomb, there's nothing there. Oh, when you turn to walk out, there's a little sign on the door that says, "He's not here, he's risen." That was the Savior of the world. That was the Savior of the world. Now Jesus appears. He appears, comes to Mary Magdalene. He tells Mary Magdalene, "Go tell Peter." He appears to Mary Magdalene again, and he appears to the other women. Report his body's been stolen. He appears to Peter. He appears to the Emmaus Road. He appears to the disciples. Thomas is not there at the time. He appears a little later. Thomas says, "My Lord and my God." He shows up there, alive, well. They saw him back to life again. Around another 40 days. That time he shows up back in Galilee and he performs the miracle catch of fishes and he appears to 500. Great commission to go to the whole world and tell them this gospel. And then suddenly while he finishes that sermon, well, let me give you the scripture exactly. "Men in white, ye men of Galilee, I stand here gazing into heaven. Same Jesus that's been taken into heaven will come again in like manner as you've seen him go into heaven again." And he's gone. He's gone to prepare a place for us. And we need to realize today that all started on Palm Sunday. That all started on the day we commemorate. I know it's not real popular among younger ministers to always have to have a sermon on a particular church holiday or religious day, but I think it's good stones to be reminded of again at times. I just want to take us there for a few minutes one more time. I want us to grasp in our heart my sermon this morning. Jesus had raised Lazarus from the dead just a couple days earlier. The sisters said, "He's been dead 4 days. He stinks." Jesus said, "Show me where you laid him." They showed him. He says, "Lazarus." He had to call Lazarus by name or everybody on earth would have come to life. "Lazarus, come forth." He's already wrapped and mummified almost. He comes hopping out of that grave. And Jesus said the most marvelous thing. Jesus said, "You untie him. You take his grave clothes off." You hear people say, you know, "We just get him in. Jesus saves him and he cleans him up." No, no. We get him in, he saves him, we clean him up. We have to get our hands dirty. The sisters said he's rotten. We have to be willing to unwrap the rotten rags off the rotten lives people have lived when we bring them into the light of the gospel. Now, we can do that legally. We can make a bunch of rules and drive them right out the door again. We can come to them with loving touch. I doubt anybody went up there and said, I wonder if I pull these off real fast if they'll hurt. Bandages hurt when you pull them off fast. I think very lovingly and gently they take off the dirty, rotten rags. We need to learn how to lovingly and gently help people shed the past of their lives and the things that hurt them so much. Now, the word had spread. He raised Lazarus from the dead. And then, guess what? He's coming from Bethany down to Jerusalem, just a short walk. He's coming that short mile down to Jerusalem, and word began to spread that guy that raised that guy from the dead is coming to Jerusalem, and they began to flock there like crazy. Well, why would they do that? I don't know. Why did I want to get my beautiful, wonderful 65 Volkswagen van, put peace signs on it, load up a bunch, and go to a place called Woodstock? By the way, if you remember what happened at Woodstock, you were not there. You want to be at the best, biggest, newest, exciting thing you hear. I got to check it. I've got to see it. I've got to go there. I look like I look because I've never heard of a restaurant I had not been to that I had to get there. One way or other, we got to go to the new place, right? Let's go see this guy. And when they heard Jesus was coming, all Jerusalem went wild. The city went crazy when he came, just as Zechariah had prophesied it. And the people took their clothes off, laid garments down on the road of his path, and they laid tree branches and palms, and they swung them up and back. Why palms? Why the branches? You go all the way back to the Old Testament and study all the Jewish festivals. The festival called the Festival of the Booths celebrated their deliverance from Egypt. And the biggest thing they did was celebrate that their deliverance was coming. They waved those palms. They picked the palms maybe for some other customs. But what they were declaring prophetically was, our deliverance is on the way. Our deliverance is coming. They had been tent dwellers. They never had a home. They followed a tent around where the cloud of God and the fire of God would settle on. They were temporarily looking forward to the day that he would not dwell in their tents anymore, but he would come dwell inside of them, as he had said. The second reason for this Palm Sunday activity was the Roman custom of that day. The Roman custom of that day was for victorious generals, that the first coming as their salvation, as their Messiah, but his position is now being changed to a military position. Now they're waving palms. They're cutting down branches. That's what they did for the military heroes. When the Roman general returned from a victory, there was a battle parade, and this is how he was given a come home, and palms and other branches were laid before him, recognizing him as a victorious general who had conquered in the battle. Wait a minute, he hadn't fought the battle yet. That's not going to happen until the next weekend. The battle was yet to be fought in the latter part of the week, but action and proclamation was a declaration that they understood he had already declared the victory over the battle that laid ahead. Yes, they will kill me, he said, but on the third day, I'll rise again. They heard that. They knew it. They were now giving already the hero's victory celebration. It's not pictured as a Roman general upon a great steed. There's no pomp. There's no circumstance. My first introduction to that was when I was just a kid. I had a cousin that worked in a high-rise in Chicago. She called my mom and said, President Eisenhower. Yeah, for some of you younger ones, I remember Eisenhower. President Eisenhower is coming to Chicago. He's coming down State Street today. His motorcade is going to pass right under my building. If you could get Sammy, that's what they call me then, if you could get Sammy on the South Shore train and get him over here at the Millennial Station, I'll pick him up and I'll bring him up to my office and we can look down the windows and we can watch it. And I remember as a young kid that trip and going up there, and I remember, oh my goodness, the parade. and you couldn't hardly see things below at times because the confetti was falling so heavy and like snow falling. And all of a sudden, I'll never forget that 19 Cadillac, that big, beautiful, white, convertible Cadillac. And sitting up there in the back seat of that Cadillac was a bald-headed old man. That's all I knew. And he had hands up there like this. And he was going like this. And the crowd was going crazy. And she said to me that day, "You'll never forget this day. Your eyes have seen the most important man in the world." That's what she said to me, an American. "Your eyes have seen the most important man in the world." So here comes Jesus on Palm Sunday, and the crowd's great, and the confetti is flying. I mean, they've got him the biggest chariot you've ever seen. He's sitting on a golden chariot, and they're screaming, and the band is playing, and they're, no. He comes in there riding on a baby donkey. I've been part of Easter productions who tried to simulate this act. It gets exciting. I saw Jesus ride across the stage one time, and I thought I was at the Kentucky Derby. Shoo, that was Jesus just went by on that donkey. Donkey decided to run that day. But this one was quiet, peaceful, palm branches laid there, laid out before him. He's not pictured as that Roman general. He's humble. He's lowly. He's one of them. He's one of them. I said in a science class that I taught a few weeks ago, you want to hear something scientific that'll blow your mind? Let's talk about the cosmos. Let's talk about the cosmos. And I took the kids through a few things on even trying to understand our own universe, much less the cosmos of more and more universes that are I have never seen, and all that's out there. And then I picked up a little thing on the desk and said, "Oh, let's travel from the cosmos to another place." And I bent and put my eyes over it, and I looked into a microscope. Microscope. From the cosmos to the microscope, couldn't even see what was in the slide if it wasn't powerfully magnified. It was so tiny, so little. And then I told him about the greatest scientific thing I'd ever known in my life, that the creator of the cosmos, the one who made what my brain is too small to even comprehend, said, "I've got to go down there and be one of them. It's the only way their sins can ever be really washed away. I've got to go down there and be one of them." And he came in microscopic form. Came in the tiniest something that no one could see. By his cosmic power, hovered over a virgin maiden and reduced the cosmos to the microscopic to put in her the possibility of a human life being born that could be brought back and reconciled to the cosmic God for all time. For all time. So why would he ride with these cheers on anything less than small, lowly, one of them? Not a victor produced by the hand of man, but a victor produced by the hand of God. That day. They thought he'll come and stop this Roman thing. They thought he would reveal himself then as the Messiah, but his victory was going to be over a greater enemy. A greater enemy than the Roman Empire. His victory was going to be over the enemy of your soul. The enemy of my soul, he was going to be victorious over. We're not looking for a victory over the Democrats. We're not looking for a victory over the Republicans. We're not looking for a victory over pro-abortionists or anti-abortionists or gay people or straight people. We're not looking for a victory over black people or white people or male or female. The victory he has given for us goes so deep and so far beyond that, I have to work to care like I should care about those other issues. I should care about them, but I got to work to care about them, because the issue is that I was on my way to hell. The warden of hell had thrown away the key, and I was never going to get it. But one day, man came, and he who knew no sin, that I might become the righteousness of God that's in Christ Jesus. He rides in. And they went from waving palms to planting thorns. They went from waving palms to planting crowns. His mockery was as much a declaration of his victory as his triumphal entrance. When he was mocked, it really was showing the victory he was going to have. You see, it was still a prediction. He would, as the status of a victorious general, he would fight the battle of the ages. He would defeat sin, death, and the grave. All mankind that would follow would believe in him, and he would absolutely wear the crown of suffering necessary. You ever think about this? Why'd they make a crown of thorns? Who prompted the first thought? Oh, he claims he's a king. Well, let's put a crown on him. Oh, I know one. Let's go to that thorn bush and get them 3-4-inch thorns. And let's wrap that kind of around some way and set that on him and shove it down in his scalp. They had no idea why they made a crown of thorns. They had no idea why they thought of thorns. Oh, that's right. Genesis chapter 3, verses 17 through 19. Did I give you that scripture? Yeah. Way back there to Adam, he said, because you listened to your wife and ate fruit from the tree about which I commanded you, you must not eat from it. Cursed is the ground because of you. Through painful toil, you'll eat bread from it all the days of your life. I will produce thorns and thistles. They weren't there in the garden. I will make them now. I will produce thorns and thistles for you, and you will eat the plants of the field, and by the sweat of your brow you'll eat your food until you return to the ground, since from it you were taken, for dust you are, and to dust you return. But after those curses, he said to Satan, and I will make you and the seed of this woman enemies. And there will come a day, you will bruise her seed's heel. You will cause her seed pain. They will take the very thing I had to make for their punishment, and he will wear that. And you won't even know why you're putting it on his head. He will wear the curses of sin on his very own head. I'll start with the first curse I ever made on man. I will bring that thorn crown on his head. You will press it there on his head with this knowledge, with this understanding that thorns and thistles will bring forth. And this curse of fallen man from the beginning will be upon him. And this crown of thorns proclaim the coming Savior, ruler of the kingdom, eternal in the heavens and earth. That crown of thorns platted on his head. He came riding in a lowly coat that day. The palms were declaring him victorious general. Not really. In mockery, they placed that crown of thorns. And then they said these words, "Behold your king. Behold your king." They were trying their best to mock. I had no idea they were proclaiming the truth. They were proclaiming the truth. Behold your king. So I got a question. That was him. That was him. Can you read Revelation 19? Start at verse 11 with me. This is latter part of the story. John, now on the Isle of Patmos, says, I saw heaven standing open, and there before me was a white horse, whose rider is called Faithful and True. With justice he judges and wages war. His eyes are like blazing fire, and on his head are many crowns. Oh, wait a minute. Many crowns. He would have not worn the many crowns if he hadn't worn the crown of thorns. He wore the crown of thorns, and on his head will be many crowns. And he has a name written on him, but no one knows it but he himself. He is dressed in a robe dipped in blood. His name is the Word of God. The armies of heaven. When did heaven put an army together? Oh, wait a minute. Yeah, by this time, a trump has sounded. And everyone that ever confessed him as Lord and Savior has left. And they're with him. And that earth has 7 years of horrible tribulation. Well, we have a 7-year banquet called the Marriage Supper of the Lamb. And at the end of that, the armies of heaven were following him, riding on white horses, dressed in fine linen, white and clean. Baby, you're going to ride a horse again, girl. I know it. We're going to do it. We're going to do it. Now watch this. Coming out of his mouth is a sharp sword with which to strike down the nations. He will rule them with the iron scepter. He treads the winepress of the fury of the wrath of Almighty God. It's what she heard sitting in a hotel window one night when she heard the first Union soldiers marching out of Washington, D.C. And she penned the words, "My eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord." He's striking. He's coming. His wrath is pouring. She believed the Civil War was the end of time when she wrote that song. We sing it in patriotism today. On his robe and on his thigh, he has this name written: King of Kings, Lord of Lords. King of Kings, Lord of Lords. So my question, that was him. But where do I fit into this whole picture? You're more than a conqueror through Christ. Listen to this. The enemy's defeated in you, and he has no more power over you. No weapon formed against you can prosper. Greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. You can wave your palm of victory today. You can wave your palm of victory today. Go ahead, wave it a minute. You can wave your palm of victory today. And your crown of glory is just around the corner. Palms of victory. Crowns of glory. One last verse this morning. No, I'm still going to preach another hour, but one last verse this morning. No, I'm not. Revelation 7. Look at verses 7 through 9. After this I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, every tribe, every people, every language, standing before the throne and before the Lamb. They were wearing white robes and were holding palm branches. We're holding palm branches, and they cried out in a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb." All the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell down, on their faces before the throne and worship him, saying, amen, praise and glory, wisdom and thanks and honor, power and strength be to our God forever and ever. Amen. 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 My mom and dad used to sing it. I told Michelle back in the office earlier, if I'd had time, I'd have got my guitar out and practiced up a little bit and sang this morning. A couple of you old ones may remember it. I'll just sing a verse and then I'll tell you what the others say. I saw a wayward traveler in garments tattered clad, traveling up the mountain. It seemed that he was sad. His back was heavy laden. His strength was almost gone. But he shouted as he journeyed, deliverance will come. Then palms of victory, crowns of glory, palms of victory I shall wear. The summer sun was shining. The sweat was on his brow, his garments worn and dusty. His steps seemed very slow, but he kept pressing onward, for he was wending his way home, still shouting as he journeyed, deliverance will come. And palms of victory, crowns of glory, palms of victory I shall wear. The songsters in the ark that stood beside the way, they attracted his attention. They invited his delay, but his watchword was onward. He stopped his ears and he ran and shouted as he journeyed, deliverance at hand. Amen. And then I saw him in the evening. The sun was getting low. He had o'ertopped the mountain and reached the valley below. He saw the golden city, his everlasting home. And he shouted out, Hosanna! Deliverance will come. I love this last verse. When gazing on the city, just o'er that narrow flood, a band of holy angels came from the throne of God. They bore him on their pinions, save o'er the dashing foam, and joined him in the triumph, because deliverance had come. And they sang palms of victory, crowns of glory, palms of victory I shall wear. Oh, palms of victory, crowns of glory, palms of victory. It's one more time. You're doing it now. There's palms of victory, crowns of glory, palms of victory I shall wear. Some of you, was that the first time some of you have ever heard that or sung that? I noticed it was the first time some of you ever clapped on the second beat, too. That was really interesting. You clapped on the two. That was amazing. Do you know him? Do you know him? Do you know him? Rick Warren's dad, the man who wrote Purpose Driven Life, was dying. And they couldn't keep him in bed. The hospital staff tried everything, but he would try every day to get out of that bed. And when they'd come to him and they'd say to him, Mr. Warren, you can't get out of bed now. You could hurt yourself. You can't get out of bed. He'd say to them desperately, but there's got to be one more. But there's got to be one more. There's got to be one more. He wanted to get to one more person to tell them about Christ. To tell them, there's got to be one more. We could sit here and lavish the fact that we're going to wear those crowns and wave those palms. I love that too. That's victory. My favorite Sunday school story I'll close with. Man was in a boat rowing it across the lake, rowing the oars. And suddenly he saw a light, something on the shore. He thought, what is that? And I got to get a little closer. And he got more across the lake, and the light got brighter and brighter. The closer he got, it got bigger and brighter. And then he was really motivated, but boy, his arms were hurting now. His back was hurting. I don't think I can make it. But he kept rowing. I got to see what that is. What is that? I've got to see what that is. No matter how much pain, no matter how much sweat, no matter how much hurt, he kept rowing. And kept rowing. Finally came into view right in the middle of that light. It was Jesus. Jesus was standing on that shore. It's Jesus. I made it. I'm going to see Jesus. I finally made it. And he rowed and he rowed and he rowed and he rowed and he finally got there. And he ran to Jesus and fell at his feet. And he said, I made it. And Jesus said, yes. Welcome home. You made it. I didn't know if you'd make it. You were so tired. Yes, I made it, I made it, I'm here. And he felt something wet fall down on him. And he looked up and there was a little tear that had dropped in Jesus' eye. Oh, Jesus, aren't you happy I'm here? I mean, you saw how I struggled. You saw my battles. You saw how tired I got. You saw how many times I wanted to quit and give up. But I didn't. I kept coming. And now you got to hear, oh, no, no, Jesus said to him. Just before he woke from his dream. Yes, I'm glad you're here, but your boat is empty. We wish you could have brought one more. My Bible says he's not willing that any perish, but that all come to repentance. Would you bow your heads for just a moment? If you're here today, do you know that if you died today, that you'll be standing, seeing Jesus face to face? You can know that. I know that. I believe that because God promised that and said it. You're here today. You're here right now. You'd say, I'd like to know that. I'm not perfect. Well, of course you're not. I don't know if I can really live a Christian life. You can't. You can't. I can't either. No one can live it perfectly. But I know one who did. And he can live it in me. And he can help me. I'd like to take one moment and say, if you're here, and you say, you know, I want to know when I walk out of here today. There may be some things in my life, amazing things. Maybe I've never made a real commitment to Christ, whatever it be. Maybe I started and I fell back. Whatever it is, I really want to know today that confidence. I want that palm of victory waving. I want to be with him that day that you talked about this morning. Would you include me in your closing prayer? That's all I'm asking you to do. Say, would you include me in prayer today? And then just pray with me for a moment. And I'll not embarrass you, I promise. I'll not single you out. I'm just asking you, would you slip a hand up and let me see it just for a moment so I know there's somebody that we can pray this prayer with today that might be here? Anyone? Yes. Yes. Thank you. Thank you. Take a moment. Another. I know there are people who say, I've been saved, given my life to Jesus a long time ago. I don't need to pray a sinner's prayer. You don't, but maybe it'll help somebody else that does. How about helping them pray their prayer? Would you all just repeat this prayer after me? Dear Lord Jesus, I believe you died for me. I believe you love me. And I believe you want me. I want to give myself to you. And I do that now. With all my problems, with all my weaknesses, I still want to belong to you. I receive you now. I confess you with my mouth. That you are my Savior, that you are my Lord, and I receive you by faith. In Jesus' name, amen. If you prayed that prayer for the first time, or it's been a long time since you prayed it, welcome to the family of God. Welcome back. Would you stand with me? The music team is going to bless us. You're welcome to stay and sing a little bit longer with them if you like. If you have to go, you can go. Did I get you out before noon?
Don't tell
my watch says hope's right. Listen, enjoy your Palm Sunday. Have a great, great time. Enjoy this week. Think every day, what was Jesus doing that week? Where was he at right now? Don't hurt, take your scripture. Read right there in Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, the story again. It's wonderful. And then be back. I mean, you'll be here. I know you'll be here Easter because even the creasters come. next Sunday.
Easter's.
That's the Christmas Easter people. They'll be here. So my goodness, why wouldn't we, right? And come, get up nice and early. That sunrise service would be great. Man, how can you pass up biscuits and gravy after a sunrise service? And then come on in, be a part of the day with us. It's going to be a great, great time. Choir practice will meet for a little bit right here after the service.
Yeah.
Let me bless you, and then we're going to sing you out of here, all right? May the Lord bless you and keep you. May he make his face to shine upon you, and may he give you his peace. May he be with you in your coming in and your going out. May he be with you in your lying down and your rising up. May he be with you in your labor and in your leisure. Till that day that we stand before him face to face, where there's no sunset.
Amen.
And no darkness.
Amen.
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 God bless you. Go in the peace of the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious.